On Linux, there are two major toolkits, GTK, or as I've taken to calling it, the GNOME toolkit. Officially, at one point in time, it was the GIMP toolkit, but we all know the truth. And the other one is Qt or Qt. No matter which way I say it, somebody is going to complain that I'm pronouncing it wrong, so I'm honestly tempted to just swap back and forth every time I mention it throughout the video. And there are plenty of other smaller projects out there like Iced and like Flutter and a bunch of other things, but those are the major focus. And a major focus for this video is Qt. So as I tend to do, I was looking around the Linux world and the programming world, looking for what news was going on, and I came across something known as Qt Bridges. So as it currently stood, Qt officially, there are plenty of other things supported as well unofficially, but officially supported three separate languages. The first one being C++. This is the main language people are going to be using. This is the most popular one, and this is the one the project originally started with. Then we have the second, that being Python. This was added back in 2018. Obviously, Python is nowhere near as fast as C++, but for building a lot of basic things, Python is totally fine. And then we have the third one, the homegrown solution, QML. This is a declarative language built within the project and was added back with the launch of Qt5 back in 2012. But as people tend to do, they're gonna want to use other languages, whether it's a language they currently know or a language they want to learn in the future, and they want to keep using the library that they like to be using. And then some developers are going to go and make some language bindings. So basically every popular language out there has a binding for Qt, whether that be Rust. Rust actually has a bunch of different ones for Qt and Qt Quick. We also have some Zig stuff here. We have C, Crystal, Nim, Go, actually a lot of Go as well. But there is a lot of options here that are unofficially supported that can be made use of. The problem though is it's often going to be like one or two people working on it. And even if people are actually, you know, actively using it, there's no guarantee it's going to be updated, that features are going to be fully supported, that, you know, it's not something that is entirely reliable to build your entire project on. So it would be nice to see core support for some more languages. And that is where Qt Bridges comes in, along with making the idea of actually building these bindings considerably easier. So recently the project released this blog post, Qt's new bridging technology, looking back to move forward. At Qt World Summit 2025, Qt Group announced a new bridging technology designed to help integrate Qt with various programming languages. And this right here just links over to the press release when they announced the matter. But this blog post has basically all the information we care about anyway. This bit here basically just explains how different language support came about, when it came about, all that fun stuff. But we'll jump to the next section right here. The birth of Qt Bridges. In late 2023, we began exploring how we could expand Qt and Qt Quick as a leading UI UX framework beyond the C++ and Python communities. Our goal is to enable new users to stay focused on their existing code bases and their preferred programming language, minimizing the effort required for refactoring to get it working with Qt. And this to me seems like the primary reason why they are taking up this endeavor, because look, C++, there's a lot of code bases out there, but when people are thinking of starting up a new project, that's usually not the language they're gonna go for. It's usually something held over with legacy code bases. And Python is nice, it's just not really that common in the way of GUI development. It's great in the compute space, big data, blah blah, AI nonsense, but when we're talking about GUIs, graphical applications, it's just never really had that hold. I think a big part of that is just, you know, the Python speed thing. It's not as bad as some people make it out to be, but it's still that sort of, I guess, aura around it. And along with this, you're seeing a lot of the newer toolkits sort of putting a lot of emphasis in cross-language support. You can use the language you want to use with this toolkit. Obviously, the web is, you know, the whole web space, but we're talking about desktop toolkits. That's something we're seeing pretty often, especially when they're trying to target mobile as well. They often want to bring those mobile developers into the same language ecosystem they were already using. Inspired by the well-known software architecture pattern of separating the backend and frontend, and drawing from multiple internal hackathon prototypes, we developed a concept for a new bridging technology. In this approach, code written in various languages serves as backend and implement business logic. So, the part of the code that does the functionality part that makes the code do important things. And the front end is the UI code written in QML and using Qt Quick UI framework. This language is specifically designed for UI development. It's not a C++, it's not a Rust. Its main primary purpose is making it easy to develop GUIs. Around May of 2024, about a year ago, we concluded that this direction could lead to tangible and interesting results. The selected hackathon prototypes fit perfectly into this and would help start things faster. By spring 2025, after 3 to 4 iterations, we had a working baseline for 5 bridges connecting different programming languages to Qt Quick. We decided to name this approach and bridging technology Qt Bridges, probably because the engineers named it, and your project is called QT. It's bridging. That's the name. This is not the first time they've used the word bridge, but they consider this not a conflict. It rather confirms the suitability of the term to describe various and a bit similar efforts across Qt and its tools. I'm sure it hopefully doesn't cause any issues when people look around for documentation. Because that's always fun. That's the problem with like reusing the same word, even if it makes sense in two different contexts. You have to like make sure you're definitely looking at the right thing. But the important thing are the languages initially being supported. So that's going to be C#, Kotlin and Java, Python, Rust, and Swift. They're also going to open and document a few private QML APIs to allow anyone to build additional language integrations in the future. Now, these language choices might seem kind of random, but they do make a lot of sense. Now, I'll get to the whole thing with Python in just a moment where that already has official support. Also, all of these, except for Swift, do have language bindings that exist. I will address that as well. So, C#, this is for the .NET ecosystem. This is for Microsofty sort of developers. For Kotlin and Java, these are your JVM languages, and these are important for the Android ecosystem. But also, maybe not as important, maybe more so. I don't know how you feel about it. A lot of the big corporate-y suit-wearing development firms really love Java. I don't know why, but especially like military contractors. Military contractors really like Java. Now, Rust should be pretty self-evident. It's the cool, hip language that everything needs to support. If you're making a new project, why not make it in Rust? Microsoft literally released a text editor not that long ago written in Rust. Why is it written in Rust? Don't think about it. Now, Swift is a very interesting choice because traditionally, this has been like a core language in the Apple ecosystem, initially being used alongside things like Objective-C. But Swift is supported on other platforms. It's just not really used that much outside of the Apple ecosystem. You can write Linux apps using Swift if you want to. So I know there's been like a push from the Swift community to sort of become a language not directly tied to Apple. Maybe that's part of why this is here. Obviously, like the main reason is for the Apple ecosystem, but I wonder if that is part of it as well. Now, as for the Python thing, why is Python included when Qt for Python already provides bindings through PySide? The answer is that PySide provides the bindings to access Qt APIs from Python, but developers still need to manually connect their Python backend to a Qt Quick frontend using various Qt API. The new bridging technology still builds on PySide and targets to offer a higher level, simpler API that makes it much easier to integrate Python backends with Qt Quick UI, removing the need to write and understand various Qt APIs. When you use a bridge, you expect a connection from one side to the other without worrying about what's underneath. a glue layer. Similarly, Qt Bridges allows developers to focus on their current code, decide which data will be exchanged across the bridge, and so design a clean data interface between the business logic written in each chosen language and the UI implemented in Qt Quick. Now the other thing is about Rust integration. Rust integration in Qt Bridges differs from CXXQT. In fact, the two are almost orthogonal. CXXQT enables Rust applications to use the Qt C++ code. In contrast, Qt Bridges is focused on use QML. Can somebody, like, please, at the Qt group, just proofread the blog post before you publish them? I keep trying to add a word here because there is a word missing. In contrast, Qt Bridges is focused on the use QML, on the use of QML, and Qt Quick on the front end, and aims to simplify and reduce the amount of bridging code required when using Rust. Now, as I showed towards the start of the video, they also have a dedicated page for this as well. Be the first to hear how Qt evolves. Qt Bridges is a future technology in the making. It will enable QML and Qt Quick to be used as a front end with various backend languages, initially Rust, Python, .NET, .NET? Do you mean C-sharp? .NET's not a language. Swift, Kotlin, and Java. This is not a yet another binding. It aims to allow a single front-end implementation to be used in any industry, on any device, and with a variety of languages. They also have this video here, which, for some reason, can people not do this? They hide the video controls? Stop it. Stop. I can, like, pop the thing out and get video controls there, but this is annoying. Don't ever do that. And if you want to sign up to their mailing list or whatever and hear about this, I guess you can go and do that. Now, personally, I've done a very little amount of Qt development in the past, and when I did, I was doing the C++ because I think at the time, Python wasn't added yet. I don't remember. Yeah, I reckon Python wasn't added yet. And I am a fan of Python myself. It's the main language I usually go to when writing scripts and stuff. Would I want to write a GUI in Python? Maybe a simple one. But probably wouldn't want to do something like crazy complex. But you know what? I could see myself playing around with some of this stuff in the future. I have wanted to get more back into doing more general development stuff. I've been doing some Godot stuff, enjoying that. That's a lot of fun, but that's sort of like side game stuff. I would like to contribute to some projects that I think are actually, you know, useful and interesting. And it's just a matter of like getting myself up to speed where I can actually, you know, provide something useful. Obviously, you're not going to have older projects migrate to this, but just getting my head back around the way Qt does things would honestly help with getting involved in anything I want to get involved in. But let me know your thoughts down below. Are you a Qt developer? Do you use Qt? Has it annoyed you that I've been changing back and forth throughout the video? I hope it has. Anyway, if you like the video, go like the video. If you really like the video and you want to become, I think this button works. It does. These amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe, and Liberopay linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and I've been controlling all of this with a Stream Deck. So I'm going to do a video on that at some point as well. Keep your eyes out for that one.